The Department of Animal Breeding and Genetics came into existence on the bifurcation of the Department of Animal Science in 1998 under PAU Ludhiana. Later on, as per new VCI guideline, the department was renamed as Department of Animal Genetics and Breeding. Department is constantly engaged in developing human resource in the field of animal breeding, animal genetics, biostatistics and computer applications, both at the undergraduate and postgraduate levels. The department is actively involved in conducting research in quantitative genetics, cytogenetics, molecular genetics, and genomics. The faculty of the department is actively involved in various research projects dedicated to the genetic improvement of dairy cattle, buffaloes, and poultry. 5 ICR and 9 state government-funded research projects are ongoing under leadership of the faculty of the department. The department is also providing consultancy services to the farmers in collaboration with livestock farms and through involvement in various extension-related activities, which livestock fairs, workshops, training, camps, etc. organized at university and state level from time to time. India has a vast animal genetic resources accommodating 10% of global livestock population under 14 livestock and 5 poultry species. The country ranks first for buffalo, second for cattle and goat, and third for sheep population. India has diverse climatic conditions, which led to evolution of broad genetic diversity, which is characterized by tolerance towards climatic variation, pathogenic infections, and parasitic infestations. Due to their resilience, the cost of rearing is minimal, leading to economical production system. These are the available registered breeds of different species in India with their respective population status. The Punjab state has 56.96% of buffalo population out of total livestock, as against 20.47% in the country. The proportion of cattle in the state is similar to the country, as about 36%. The 44% of livestock population consists of other species, with goat, sheep, pig, yak, mithun, camel, etc. in the country, against 7% of the same in Punjab. Animal genetic resources of Punjab. The indigenous breeds of cattle found in state includes mainly Sahiwal, Rathi, Haryana and their grades, whose pure and graded population is more than 10,000. Haryana cattle are maximum in number. However, the home track of Sahiwal cattle is mainly in Punjab state. Sahiwal, a breed originated in Punjab, is a global animal genetic resource recognized as international transboundary breed by FAO in 2007, facing threat. As Sahiwal breed is found in more than 29 countries, therefore, this breed of cattle needs prime attention in the state policy. At the same time, large dairy herds of exotic cattle breeds and their crosses should also be improved to increase milk production in the state. Buffalo. Nili Rabi buffalo breed has been originated from Punjab, but presently Nili Rabi and its grades are approximately 4.95 lakhs. Murrah breed perhaps got preferences by the dairy farmers in the state. Therefore, these two breeds need due attention, as more than 70% of milk is produced by the buffaloes in the state of Punjab. Among the small ruminants, in Punjab, goat population includes mostly Beetle and Barbary breeds. However, other breeds are very less in number, and 23.8% of total goat are nondescript. Though goats are distributed in all the districts of Punjab, but Firozpur, Bathinda and Muktsar are the leading districts in goat rearing. Sheep. The exotic and crossbred sheep are mostly of Corridale and Merino breeds. Chokla, Gaddi, Magra and Marbadi sheep are more in number as compared to other indigenous sheep breeds. However, about 40% of sheep population is classified as nondescript in the state. A new population, Kajli, has been identified and characterized from Punjab state and registered as a new sheep breed of India. Animal husbandry sector in Punjab is contributing about 13% of its GDP. As per the Livestock Census 2019, there are 40.15 lakhs buffaloes and 25.31 lakhs cattle in the state. Buffaloes are contributing more than 70% of milk produced in the state. In Punjab, the average milk productivity is 8.44 kg per day for buffalo, 13.4 kg per day for crossbred or exotic cattle, nearly 8 kg per day for indigenous cow and about 1.5 kg per day for goat, that is highest among all the states of the country. Punjab contributes about 6.7% of the total milk production of India, from less than 2% of total bovine population of the country. The per capita availability of the milk in Punjab is 1,181 gram, which is highest in the country and more than many developed countries of the world. About 71.8 million poultry of the state contribute 4,783 million eggs per annum, with per capita availability of 155 eggs, which is also the highest in the country. Annual meat production is 248.84 thousand tons.
Characterization of different breeds in Punjab. First is Mora. It is also known as Kundi or Kali or Delhi Buffalo in India. Mora means curled. It is one of the best milch breed of buffaloes. Breeding track in Haryana. It is found in Rohtak, Hisar and Jind districts. In Punjab, it is found in Nabha and Patiala district. And in Delhi, it is found in the southern part. Physical characteristics. Body is heavy and wedge-shaped. Head is comparatively small. Face and neck are comparatively long. Body color is jet black. Horns are tightly curved in a spiral form and are short in size. Tail is long and reaching up to fetlock joint. Udder is fully developed and drooping with equally distributed teats over the udder. Teats are long, uniformly placed and are wider apart, but the hind teats are longer than fore teats. The average milk yield per lactation is nearly about 2500 kg and maximum has been reported more than 4500 kg. The milk fat is nearly about 7.3%. Uniqueness of the breed, they are known for their longevity and persistent yield even in the later lactations. It is bred either in pure form or is being used for the grading up of local buffaloes. It has been exported to many developing countries and is bred there. Second is Nili Ravi Buffalo. It is also known as Panch Kalyani. It is one of the best milch breed of Punjab. It has been found in Firozpur, Amritsar and Fazilka district of Punjab. Physical characteristics. Body is large sized, having a deep and low set frames. Head is elongated, bulging at the top and is depressed between the eyes. Body color is normally black. The horns are tightly curved and circular in cross section and but smaller in size. Walled eyes and white markings on the forehead, face, muzzles, legs and tail is one of the most prominent visible characteristics of the Nili Ravi buffaloes. Tail is thick at the base, gradually tapers towards the end and extends below the hocks with a wide switch. Udder is well shaped and capacious. Teats are long and evenly squarely placed. The average milk yield per lactation is nearly about 2200 kg and maximum has been reported up to 4000 kg. Third is Gojri buffaloes. The name has been derived from the word Gujjar as it plays a significant role in securing the livelihood for the Gujjars, and these buffaloes are considered as a symbol of wealth in their community. They are mainly employed for the milk and draught. The breeding track has been found in Pathankot, Hosharpur, SAS Nagar, Roopnagar of the Punjab and Kangra and Chamba district of Himachal Pradesh. Physical characteristics, body is proportionate and medium built with a thick skin. The body color is brown or black. Head is straight with a patch of white hairs, mostly observed in 65% of the animals. Horns are heavy and medium sized and mostly curved to form a big loop. Udder are round and medium in size. Teats are cylindrical with the pointed tips. The average milk yield is nearly about 1000 kg. Fourth is Sahiwal breed of cattle. It is also known as Montagiri, Multani, Lambibar, Lola. It is one of the best dairy breed of the Zebu cattle in India. In Punjab, it has been found in Firozpur, Amritsar and Fazilka district. And in the Rajasthan, it has been reported in Shirin Ganganagar district. physical characteristics, the coat color is reddish dun, but pale red or brownish red are also reported. Horns are stumpy and short to the medium, running outwards, upwards, and then inwards. Skin is loose, dewlap is large and heavy, tail is long and fine with a black switch reaching almost to the ground. Udder are large bowl shaped, pliable, and firmly suspended from the body. Teeth are large, cylindrical, and uniform in size and squarely placed. The average milk yield per lactation is nearly about 2300 kg with a fat percent of nearly about 4.9%. Uniqueness of this breed, because of its desirable traits, it is being widely utilized in many warm, humid countries of the world for the improvement of local stock or for the initial crossbreeding of the indigenous stock before uptaking the upgrading with the European breeds. Fifth is Gir cattle. It is also known as Dassan, Gujarati, Kathiawadi, Surati. It is found in Junanagar, Rajkot and Amreli districts of the Gujarat. Physical characteristics. Body color varies from shades of red and white to almost black. Forehead is prominent, convex and broad like bony shield. Ears are long and pendulous and folded like a leaf with a notch at the tip. Horns are curved, thus giving a half moon appearance. Tail is long and whip like. Udder is round and well developed. The hip bones are prominent. It is the world's most renowned breed, known for its tolerance to the stress conditions. It has a capacity for yielding more milk with less feeding and is quite resistant to various tropical diseases. It has been imported by Brazil, USA, Mexico and bred there successfully. Indo Brazil is a strain which has been developed by a cross between Gir and Kankrej. The average milk yield per lactation is nearly about 2100 kg with a fat of nearly about 4.6%. Sixth is Holstein Friesian. The breeding track is in Holland. It is one of the largest dairy breed with the highest milk production. Physical characteristics. Body is strong, heavy and well developed. Body color has the typical markings of black and white. Nose is broad. Forehead is dished. Face and muzzles are white. Legs are long, but the lower part of the legs are mostly white. Udder is large. The Holstein produce vigorous calves, which has been distinguished by rapid growth, early maturity, and easy care. If they are managed well, they exhibit no fertility problems. Highest milk yield and ability to produce high quality beef with a fine fiber in a short period is one of the unique qualities of this breed. The HS are extensively used in the crossbreeding programs of India, and the cross of HF produces nearly about 15 to 20 liters per day. Seventh is Jersey. Its breeding track is the island of Jersey, which is in UK. It is one of the smallest dairy breed. Physical characteristics. The body is compact and angular. The body color varies from reddish fawn with or without markings and generally black around the eyes. Forehead is dished. Head is clean cut and proportionate to the body. Eyes are large and bright. Because of their small size, Jersey requires less feed and thus the production costs are less. They have an excellent conformation, reproduction efficiency, early maturity and longevity. They have highest fertility and are known for ease of calving. In India, this breed has acclimatized well and is widely used in crossbreeding programs with the indigenous cow. In Australia, it has been used for the basis for the development of Australian Milking Zebu, a synthetic cross of Zebu and Taurus dairy breed. Likewise, it has been a major contributor to the inheritance of Jamaica Hope breed. Eighth is Beetle breed of goat. It is also known as Amritsari. The name has been derived from its place of origin, that is Patala, Tehsil of Gurdaspur district of Punjab. It is mostly found in Firozpur, Amritsar and Gurdaspur district of Punjab. It is mainly used for milk and meat. Physical characteristics. The body color predominantly varies from black or brown with the white spots of different sizes. coat is short and lustrous. Face line is convex with typical Roman nose. Ears are long and flat, curled, slightly drooping. The horns are thick, medium size, carried horizontally with a slight twist directed backward and upwards. Tail is small and thin. The udders are large and well-developed with the large conical teats. The average milk yield is 2 to 4 kg per day with a fat percent of 5.03%. Ninth is Kajli breed of sheep. The name has been derived from the collyrium or the black circle around the eyes. It is also known as Kali Kajli and Chitti Kajli. It is one of the heaviest sheep of the country. It is primarily used for mutton along with wool and manure. In Punjab, it has been found in Sangrur, Barnala, Ludhiana and Moga district. Physical characteristics, two color variants. One is black with a complete black or black brown or with a brown body. Second, white with black or dark brown circle around the eyes or in the face with varying degree. Two color variants, black with complete black or black brown or brown body. Second, white with black or brown dark circle around the eyes and in the face with a varying degree. Body is large in size and well built with a Roman nose. Ears are long, flat and pendulous or the leafy. Tail is thick, round and long, touching up to the ground. It produces white or black or brown colored coarse wool nearly about 0.8 to 1 kg. The farmers prefer it because of its fast growth and good mutton quality, and it is quite well adapted to the geographical area of Punjab.
So moving to the next topic in the series, that is indigenous and exotic pig genetic resources for intensive farming. Present scenario of day by day increasing population and limited agricultural produce may generate challenges to meet growing demand of food. Since few decades, pig farming has been seen as an important opportunity for the supply of animal meat, as it needs low initial investment and hefty profit can be made within a short span of time. Rearing of pigs under intensive system using improved technologies for commercial production has become imperative not only for realizing their full potential but also to meet the increasing demand of raw as well as processed pork in the domestic as well as global markets. Recommendation of a breed for intensive farming depends on preference of the farmers, availability of the animals and demand of the consumers. However, the major driving force for choice of the breed should be management practices and available inputs, body size and carcass quality, hardiness and adaptability of the animals, feed conversion ratio, fertility and litter size, survivability and disease resistance, besides breed characteristics. The choice of the breed changes as per the management and inputs, as hardy and adaptability breeds and their crosses are suitable for small scale and backyard farming, while they fall short for profitability due to lesser body size, FCR and fecundity. Till date, a total of 10 indigenous breeds of pig, namely Agunda Goan from Goa, Doom from Assam, Kunguru from West Bengal and Tripura, Gura from Uttar Pradesh, Mali from Tripura, Niang Megha from Meghalaya, Nicobari from Andaman and Nicobar Islands, Purnia from Bihar and Jharkhand, Tenvivo from Nagaland, Zovak from Mizoram have been registered by the National Bureau of Animal Genetic Resources, that is Nodal Agency for Livestock Breed Registration in India. However, considering the merits and shortcomings of indigenous breeds, only Ghungru breed can be used as purebred for commercial pig farming, while crosses of rest of the indigenous breeds with exotic pigs can be used for small-scale farming. So here we can see the important information of Ghungru breed. The Ghungru breed is originated from West Bengal and adjoining states. Pigs are used for pork and manure production. The Ghungru breed is having broad, flattened face with heart-shaped drooping ears. Animals of this breed are mainly black in color. Occasionally, hoofs and metapodials are white. Wrinkles are there in the body of the animals, especially in shoulders and abdominal area.
The snout of the pigs are upwardly curved. Pigs has thick coats and long hair coat, and tail is long and thin. The body weight of boar is about 250 kg and of sow it is 190 kg. Litter size in this breed is nearly 8 to 18 piglets per litter. The majority of the commercial farms, however, are oriented mainly towards profitability and thus follow intensive system of pig rearing with abundant inputs. So, the choicest breeds are those having such qualities which we have discussed in the previous slides. The exotic breeds like Large White Yorkshire, Landrace, Duroc and Hampshire are popular in Punjab and can be recommended as suitable for intensive farming because of their qualities. Before purchasing the animals, we must know about the important breed characteristics of the animals in order to differentiate the purebred from the admixture one. So in this series, first exotic breed of pig is Large White Yorkshire. Large White Yorkshire breed is native to England. This is the most abundant breed of India. Pigs are reared mainly for pork production. Animals are having large and well-built body, long head and mouth, dished face with erect ears, long neck full to the shoulder, pinkish skin and white hairs, snout of medium length and tail is set high. Body of the animals is free from wrinkles and having long and moderately fine coat. Sows are having good maternal instinct. This breed is widely used for crossbreeding and breed improvement of local pigs. Animals are well adapted to a diversified climate. Body weight of the boar is from 300 to 400 kg and sows is between 230 and 320 kg. Highly prolific breed, having litter size about 10 to 12 piglets per litter. The next breed is Landrace. The home track of Landrace breed is Denmark. The Landrace breed is used mainly for pork production. The animals are white in color, sometimes black patches, that is called freckles, present all over the body. Animals are having large and long built. Coat color of Landrace breed is pink. Bristles are white and have trim jaw. This breed has heavy drooping ears, which is slanting forward and covering most of the face. Animals are having relatively short legs and long snout as compared to Large White Yorkshire. Animals are efficient in utilizing feed. Landrace breed is famous for giving large litter. And this breed is used for breed improvement of the local pigs. This breed has adapted well under Indian conditions. The carcass quality is close to Large White Yorkshire. The body weight of boar is approximately from 270 to 360 kg and of sow it is from 200 to 320 kg. Sow gives 9 to 10 piglets per farrowing. Next is Duroc breed. Origin of Duroc breed is United States. Animals are reared mainly for pork production. This breed is actually cross of two breeds, that is Jersey Red and Duroc of New York. Animals of this breed have moderately red colored skin with shades varying from golden to cherry red color. Face is slightly dished and ears are drooping. Animals are having large frame and muscular body. Duroc breed is well known for excellent weight gain and a high feed conversion ratio. This breed is popular for color, hardiness and fast growth. Females are having good maternal ability and the animals have good carcass quality also. Adult body weight of boar is 400 kg and of sow is about 350 kg. Sow produces large litter up to 15 piglets. Next is Hampshire breed. Hampshire breed was developed in USA. This is the oldest American breed of hawks. The animals are black in color with white patches on chest area. Animals have long and well-built body, medium-sized erect ears and long tail. Females of Hampshire breed have good maternal instinct and are good milker. Hampshire breed is famous for producing excellent lean quality meat. Also, The adaptability of the animal of this breed in diversified Indian climate is good. Body weight of mature boar is about 150 to 250 kg, and for sow it is 90 to 200 kg. Litter size in this breed is about 8 per farrowing. Besides this, important economic traits like litter weight, weaning weight, market weight, age for slaughter weight, average daily gain in weight, feed conversion ratio, under growth and feed efficiency traits, litter size, mothering ability and viability of piglets under reproduction and survival, back fat thickness and dressing percentage under carcass quality traits need to be considered while selection of breeds and breeding stock within the farm.
Chromosome complement of farm animals. The diploid chromosome number in both exotic and Zebu cattle is 60. The major difference is in the Y chromosome, that is submetacentric in exotic and acrocentric in the Zebu cattle. The riverine and swamp buffaloes have 50 and 48 number of chromosomes respectively. 5 pairs of autosomes are meta or submetacentric, whereas rest of the chromosomes, including the sex chromosomes, are acrocentric. The sheep and goat have 54 and 60 number of chromosomes respectively. In this species, the X chromosome is acrocentric, whereas the Y chromosome is metacentric. In other farm animal species, like pig have 38, horse 64, and camel 74 number of diploid chromosomes. For illustration, in the metaphase plate of indigenous cattle, only the X chromosome is submetacentric. The Y chromosome is the smallest acrocentric. All the autosomes are acrocentric. In the metaphase plate of exotic cattle, both the X and Y chromosomes are submetacentric. All the autosomes are acrocentric, like that of the indigenous cattle. In the riverine buffalo, 10 number of autosomes are submetacentric. The rest of the chromosomes are acrocentric. The X chromosome is the largest acrocentric and Y chromosome is the smallest acrocentric.
Topic which is about linkage. As we know, organisms have large number of genes. Their number is more than the number of chromosomes. It means that a large number of genes are located on each chromosomes. The genes located on the same chromosomes are transmitted together in the offsprings and are called linked genes. So, since there are a large number of genes and a few chromosomes, so it is quite obvious that many genes are located on the same chromosome, and genes located on the same chromosome are known as the linked genes. The theory of linkage was advanced by T.H. Morgan in 1911. The phenomenon of inheritance of linked genes together so as to retain the parental combinations in the offsprings is known as linkage. So due to linkage, the parental combinations of the genes are retained from the ancestors to the progeny generation. Genes located on a single chromosome constitute a linkage group. The total number of linkage groups in an organism corresponds to the haploid number of chromosomes or is equal to the number of chromosome pairs. For example, in Drosophila, we are knowing that there are 8 chromosomes, so there are 4 linkage groups, and in human beings there are 23 linkage groups and 7 in sweet pea. Coming to the difference between linkage and independent assortment. When two pairs of genes A and B are located on different chromosomes, they assort independently in the gametes. As a result, 4 types of gametes are formed in equal proportions. Whereas in linkage, these genes A and B are present on the same chromosome, And if no crossing over occurs between the two genes, only two types of gametes are formed in equal numbers. Each gamete receives the allele present on one homologue or the other. The gametes possess only parental or non-crossover gene combinations. So this is the picture in which we can see independent assortment of two genes on two different homologous pairs of chromosomes. We can see the capital A and capital B, these are the dominant genes, and small we are the recessive genes. And we can see that there are four types of gametes which are possible. This is the case of independent assortment, where the genes are located on different chromosomes. This is the pictorial representation of what will happen in case of linkage between two genes which are located on the same chromosome. Capital A and capital B indicate the dominant genes which are located on the same chromosome. Small b indicate the genes which are located on the same chromosome in the parents. And this individual is going to produce only two type of gametes. One type carrying capital A and capital B genes, and the other one carrying the recessive type of genes. This is what the progeny of a test cross involving two pairs of genes will be like. We will take the parents which are homozygous dominant and cross them with the homozygous recessive parent. So the F1 generation will be heterozygous. They will be capital A small a, capital B small b. Now we will go for test cross, and this F1 individual will be crossed with the double recessive parent. So the progeny generation, if it is a case of independent assortment, we will find the F2 offsprings will be both types, parental as well as recombinant types, and they will be in equal proportion. Each combination will be represented by 25%. Whereas in case of complete linkage, where there is no crossing over, F2 generation, only parental type of combination of offsprings will be there. Coming to the chromosome theory of linkage formulated by Morgan and Castle, genes that show linkage are located on the same chromosome. Genes are arranged in a linear fashion on the chromosome. Distance between linked genes is inversely proportional to the strength of linkage, because the greater the distance between the genes, the greater will be the chance of crossing over. And the lesser the distance between the genes, stronger will be their linkage. Linked genes remain in their original combination during the course of inheritance. Distance between linked genes is determined by the percentage of crossing over. Coming to the arrangement of linked genes, there are broadly two arrangements which is seen in individual which is heterozygous for two pairs of linked genes, can be either of two types: cis arrangement or coupling state, trans arrangement or repulsive state. In the cis arrangement, as you can see has been shown in the diagram below, the dominant allele will be on one chromosome and the recessive allele will be on the other homologous chromosome. So both the dominant alleles in case of cis arrangement will be on one chromosome and the recessive will be on the other. Whereas in case of trans arrangement or repulsive state, the dominant allele of one gene and the recessive allele of the other gene are located on one chromosome of the pair. Coming to the difference between complete and incomplete linkage. In case of complete linkage, the linked genes are transmitted together to the offspring generations, and only parental combinations appear for two or more generations. No non-parental combinations will be seen, and only two types of gametes having genes in the parental combinations are produced. Such gametes are called as non-crossover gametes. Complete linkage is rare, and in Drosophila, all mutant alleles present on fourth chromosome show complete linkage. Whereas in incomplete linkage, there is new or non-parental combination of genes is observed. It means linked genes separate in some cases as a result of crossing over. This is a common phenomenon in all organisms. Coming to the factors affecting strength of linkage, with increase in age, the chances of crossing over decreases. Increase in temperature increases the frequency of chiasmata formation and decreases strength of linkage. Exposure to X-rays reduces strength of linkage.
Livestock record keeping for the improvement of the livestock in genetic terms. The record keeping plays a pivotal role in improving any practice on the livestock farms. It may require the farmer to put time and effort into faithfully maintaining records. However, the benefits, those are observed in terms of improvement in the management, production, reproduction, and marketing planning aspects are so enormous that they make the effort equally rewarding for the farmers. The record keeping may be as detailed or as simple as the one keeping the records desires. Decisions like selection, breeding, culling, replacement, purchase, housing, feeding, health management, and marketing of the animals and at farm resources can be more efficient if they are based on the records. Records are of two types, temporary and permanent. For any kind of record, however, each animal in the herd should have a unique identification number, and individual permanent records that has to be initiated at the birth or the purchase of the animal. Now, events of the importance like artificial insemination, calving, drying, etc. should be recorded immediately in temporary registers with all the pertinent details available, like dates and the animal IDs. The records can later be transferred to the permanent record registers. The format of sections may vary as per the convenience, but the contents are of the importance. Records to keep are usually similar for all livestock record keeping systems because they all share some basic elements. Keeping records on individual animals is very important as it is essential for realistic evaluation rather than depending on the generic estimate of the performance of the animals. Some of the key records to keep include the herd status and pedigree records. The recording of the category-wise herd strength helps in determining the actual performance level of the herd. The record of total number of the animals in categories of calves, their sex, yearlings, heifers, lactating, pregnant, and dry cows should be kept in the herd registers. The date of calving or birth of all the animals as well as all other important events must also be maintained for each animal in calving registers. The recording the sire and dam of the animals, their breed composition and production details in individual pedigree cum history sheets may help fetching good prices while selling the surplus animals. The stock registers should contain the routine monitoring of the feed offered and actually consumed amount in the feed stock registers. That can help in tuning up the feed composition of the animals with respect to their requirements. Stock registers should be maintained for all consumables like medicines and cleaning supplements, etc. The growth registers should record birth weight of the every animal, followed by monthly birth weights up to 3 months and quarterly birth weights up to the desirable age like 1 or 2 years, followed by the birth weights at their key physiological statuses. The health register contains the records on vaccination, disease incidences, veterinary visits, and the treatment regimes that have been followed on the animals. It aids the veterinary professionals to follow through the history of the animals for the correct diagnosis and formulation of proper line of treatment and to evaluate the animal's response to treatment. It goes without saying that a better diagnosis leads to better treatment and a healthier herd leads to better profits. The reproduction records contains the dates and events of artificial insemination and pregnancy diagnosis tests and their results. The recording date of heat in cow is of utmost importance because it indicates the cyclicity status of the cows and enables the farmers for planning timely insemination of the animals, leading to better conception, thus cutting the cost of rearing the animals at their unproductive state. Recording the service bull helps in keeping the pedigree record of the animals, which is a must in genetic evaluation of the animals. The production records, if we specifically talk about the dairy animals, it includes the daily milk yields that helps to check on the milk payments and optimize the feeding regimes, the regular milk composition data on fat, SNF, lactose, etc. can be used to monitor the effect of the diet and the animal's adaptability. Thus, a viable practice in milk recording is for milk and milk fat to be estimated from fewer measures made at regular intervals throughout the lactation. For reducing the load and the labor requirement, the lactation may be recorded at 5th, 35th, 95th, so on monthly intervals up to 305 days. This is a widely accepted practice for balance between the need of the accuracy and economy while recording the dairy animals. Lastly, the record of expenditure and profit, as in terms of sales, purchase, labor, equipment, and other investment on the services like veterinary ads, must be kept in records properly to ensure the economic viability of the livestock keeping. Now, these are the raw records on the animals, but these should not be as such used for evaluating the herd status or the animal's superiority. So we need to derive certain traits for the genetic evaluation and genetic improvement of the animals. The most used indicators are the herd average, which is an indicator of the overall herd milk productivity, and it is calculated as the ratio of total milk produced in a day by the number of the breedable females. The wet average, which is reflective of the overall productivity status of all the productive animals, and it is the ratio of total milk produced in a day by the number of total lactating animals. The conception rate is reflective of the fertility status of the animals as well as of the herd, and it is calculated as the ratio of successful AI to total number of AIs performed and expressed as in terms of percentages. The productivity status of the dairy animals is reflected as 305 days milk yield, and it can be calculated from the test day milk yields as the summation of the average of the two consecutive test day milk yields into the interval between the two consecutive test days. The 305 days fat yield can be estimated as 305 days into the average fat percentage throughout the lactation. Now, this records that we have maintained and generated needs to be utilized for genetic improvement. The aim of any breeding scheme is to move the genetic change in desirable direction through selection of the parent candidates and further mating plan of the years. The superiority of the selected individuals is at first visualized through what we refer as selection differential, which is calculated as the difference of individuals' own performance to the herd average. Further, a single value or simple averages must never be used for decision on selection and culling of the animals at herd, as they are more reflective of the phenotypes. This phenotype is an accumulation of the genetic and environmental effects and their interplay. As the total phenotypic variance is equal to the summation of the genetic variance and environmental variance, which can be further divided as the genetic variance is divided as the additive genetic variance, dominance variance, and epistatic variance. The environmental variance is divided to permanent environment and temporary environment, and their interplay is regarded as a correlation between genotype and environment and interaction between genotype and environment. Here, additive genetic variance is of particular interest, as dominance and interactions are rearranged every generation due to random assortment of the alleles. This additive variance as a portion of total phenotypic variance is called as heritability in narrow sense. The heritability in narrow sense can be calculated for any trait by the use of the available records on the SIBs as intra-sire or intra-dam correlation among the half-SIBs or full-SIBs. Secondly, by the regression of offsprings on the parents, taking the decords available on the parents and progenies. Thirdly, it can be calculated using the selection experiments as realized heritability. And lastly, it can be calculated using all animals records in animal models, which of course requires the records on all the animals along with the pedigree records of all of them. The most important aspect of genetic improvement scheme is to quantify the genetic progress made so far and the accuracy of the selection scheme. The formula for accuracy of the selection reflects the importance of accurate and frequent recording of data, as the accuracy of selection is proportional to the heritability and number of observations. The accuracy of the heritability estimate is further dependent on the accuracy of the records those are available, because the heritability estimate is very sensitive to the records on the offsprings or the source of the data that is being used for calculation of the heritability. The number of observations are very crucial, because the accuracy of selection depends directly on the number of observations. Increasing the number of observations increase the accuracy of selection. Further, if we discuss about the response to selection, it also heavily depends on the recordings numbers as well as heritability estimates. Lastly, it also depends on the selection differential or intensity of selection, which also can be improved by recording a larger number of animals. Coming to the successful operation of the genetic improvement scheme, besides for a better management of the farm, performance recording of individual animal is very precious source that can be utilized for selection and culling decision of the for the genetic improvement. For the record to be utilized for breed improvement purpose, the data needs to be validated and reliable. Cooperation between the farmers and the field recorder is a basic requirement for the successful operation of any recording scheme. This cooperation can only come through an understanding of the use of records and uniformity of the recording system, besides the awareness among the farmers. A reasonably accurate progeny testing of the bull can be obtained not only from the complete record on fewer animals, but it can also be obtained from fewer records from a larger number of progenies. These estimated genetic worth, those are called as the breeding value, can be used as a reference for selection of the breeding stock, identification of the elite animals among the herd, and decision of replacement heifers and voluntary culling. By that, an overall improvement in the genetic performance of the herd can be achieved.
The present topic is genetic improvement of dairy animals through progeny testing. So, under this, there are many factors involved, such as breeding goal of dairy animals, types of genetic resources, dairy animals breeding policy and programs, scientific intervention and human resources, performance recording, progeny testing, evaluation of breeding bull, even in the field or farm, use and dissemination of superior germplasm, and exploiting the future animal breeding technologies. Now we will discuss about progeny testing in detail. The selection criteria for evaluating an individual based on his progeny performance is known as progeny selection of progeny testing. The progeny of an individual is the index or parent's genetic worth. Each progeny inherits one half of the genes from each parent due to having nature of inheritance. This is known as transmitting ability of the parents, and the breeding value of the parent is twice the mean deviation of progeny from the population mean. The progeny testing can be conducted at farm level or field level or former herd level, is known as field progeny testing program. What is the strategy, or what should be the strategy for field progeny testing program, in which the bulls are considered to be the most important players for carrying out organized breeding services, as the main objective of breeding like development of foundation stock, increase in productive capacity and reproductive efficiency of the local stock through genetic upgradation cannot be achieved without them. They are the reservoirs of the required germplasm or genetic potentialities, which is transmitted to subsequent generation to their offspring. Once it is established in the offspring or progenies, no extra cost is required to transmit these characters for further inheritance, unlike the case of environmental component like the managemental practices, which needs constant investment. On the other hand, selection of breeding bull is an important factor for attaining the desired result. By observing only the body conformation, phenotypic characteristics or pedigree records, it is not accurate to judge the genetic potential of a bull. Progeny testing, therefore, basing on the adequate information, gives an accurate estimate of breeding value for assessing the genetic potentialities and is therefore preferred when the animal is used for breeding. Now, there are several steps are involved in the field progeny testing program. Like, first, if you want to go into the field, so the field may be district level or subdivision level or block level or village level, then selection of bull for the testing. It is very important to select the bull which is to be used for the test. Then we have to plan the orientation program for this field progeny testing, that means roadmap. Then identification of cluster in each block. Then farmer awareness program, because all the field animal will be kept by the farmer, so farmer must aware about that. Then registration and identification of cow and their artificial insemination, maintenance of records, follow-up of inseminated cows, detection and follow-up of progenies, organization of calf rallies or shows whenever required, organization of infertility and camp, treatment camp, etc. Breeding the female progeny attaining the maturity, recording of the milk. Thereafter, after having the complete record of the milk, at least for a first lactation, now we will start to estimate the probable breeding value of sires, which will be based on the milk yield, heritability and progeny per bull. The breeding value of each bull is estimated for its potentialities and ranked accordingly. Sire are to be evaluated on the basis of their daughter's 305 days milk yield in the single or multiple herd, whatever we have the resources. All the sires are ranked on the basis of their sire index, of which 20-30% top ranking bull shall be selected for future use as proven bull for production of superior germplasm for the next generation. This has ensured sustained maintenance and production of improved germplasm on a large scale for use in cattle and buffalo improvement program and for establishing linkage with other institutions in India. There are some merits and demerits of the progeny testing program. So, the merits are, the progeny testing is best method or better method for sex-limited traits, the trait with low heritability and slaughter trait in meat animals. The progeny testing is useful to improve a sire whether he is free from any recessive gene. The main feature and principal advantage of progeny testing is the increased selection intensity. Now, demerit of progeny testing are the time and cost required is the main limitation. It increases the generation interval. Due to large generation interval, the genetic gain per year is low. Progeny testing is effective on adequate number of progeny. It requires to progeny test and compare many sires to find which one is the superior. Now, in continuation to that, the utilization of progeny test data for sire evaluation. That means how we will use, or farmer can use, or breeder can use the progeny recorded data for sire evaluation further. The result of progeny testing is expressed in the form of an index, which is the index of genetic worth of the sire, and such index is known as sire index. Based on the sire index, a numerical value is obtained which indicates the producing ability of the sire, since a number of sires are progeny tested is required to rank all the sires on their genetic worth or breeding value so as to select the best sire. For maximizing the genetic gain by sire evaluation, it is essential that the method of estimating breeding values of sire should be unbiased and efficient. The breeding value refers to the average genetic effect of the genes passed on by the individual on its offspring and is estimated to know whether the individual is genetically superior to the individuals or not for the trait concerned. A sire production's transmitting ability can be estimated by mathematical means and expressed as a single figure known as sire index. In other words, an attempt to express what a sire would have produced. Has he been a cow? Is the sire index of that bull. Now there are several methods of sire indexing, out of which few important index we will discuss. First one is simple daughter average. In this, the simplest way to evaluate a bull is by his daughter's production alone. That method was given by Edward in 1932. The fault with this method is that it doesn't consider the probable contribution of the dam. It would be alright if all the bulls were bred to average group of cows. Second method is equiparent or intermediate or dairy bull index. That was developed by Yap in 1925. Is based on principle that the two parents contribute equally to the genetic makeup of the progeny. This index overestimates the breeding value of a sire mated to set of dams inferior on the average and underestimates if dam happens to be superior on the average to the general level of herd. Third method is Mount Hope index. That was developed by Goodale in 1927. In that method, it is suggested that in mating between animal of unequal level of milk production is on the average about 7 by 10 of the distance above the level of the lower parent, while butterfat production is about 4 by 10 of the distance above the lower level. To get this index, compute the average mature equivalent of milk production of the dam of these daughters and take the difference between these averages. Next method is Hazard's index. This index is used to determine the transmitting ability of individual bull with regard to milk production. This method is based on progeny selection. Next method is Gifford index. In this index, the bull value is estimated from the daughter's record, ignoring the dams, provided the dams are not a selected group. That means sire index will be equal to twice the daughter average minus herd average. Next method is regression index or Rice index. Regression in the biological sense means the degree of relationship between parents and offspring when used as a measure of inheritance. The regression could move forward as well as backward or toward breed average. Rice has proposed this index based on the fact that the overall regression of the daughter's record on those of their dams was approximately 0.5. This index simply regresses the equal parent index halfway. Next is Tomar index, which is depends on dam-daughter comparison and on simultaneous use of merits of dam and the daughter over their contemporary herd averages. Next is corrected daughter average index. This index corrects the daughter average for the influence of different production level of dams shared by different bulls on the basis of regression of daughters record on dams. Next is dairy search index. Under Indian condition, evaluation of bull is made with information from a very few daughters and from record subjected to serious environmental differences. Sundarsan in 1965 gave two methods, one for sire evaluation at farm level and another for key village system. So the next method is contemporary comparison method. If changes in the environment condition from time to time significantly, then the relevant record made a different time needed adjustment. The value was based on comparison of average of daughters of the bull with average of contemporary daughters of the same group but sired by different bulls. The difference between the two average was weighted for the number of heifer in each sire group. The contemporary group will allow effective adjustment of major environmental effects. Now next is least square constant. The sire constants are obtained by least square techniques, which adjust the data for all the environmental effects, including the non-orthogonality in data. Next method is best linear unbiased prediction. This is the most commonly used method and very popular to estimate the breeding value of a sire. When the performance record are used as clues in selection index, it is automatically assumed that the records have been adjusted previously for all known source of environmental bias using adjustment factors. This method was given by Henderson and co-workers in 1975 is mainly based on least squares method. The basic steps involved in BLEP estimates are as expression that describes an individual's performance in terms of all factors that need to be taken into account, that is herd, year and season in the model. BLEP is the best method for evaluating the breeding value of a bull and rank the sire according to their genetic merit because of the following reasons, such as corrects the data automatically for all non-genetic sources, estimates simultaneously all factors concerned, uses available a priori information more efficiently and more flexibly, maximizes the correlation between predictor and predict, provides an estimate of response to selection for group of animals born in different years.
To watch more educational videos on veterinary and animal sciences, subscribe the channel and please touch the bell icon. Guru Angad Dev Veterinary and Animal Sciences University, Ludhiana on YouTube.